that was, I think, the problem.
I was just so perplexed by it at the time. But
indeed.
I'm interested now because Brazil have been one of the only teams to consistently ban out Soraka. Will they leave it available and look to first rotation it here? Or will they ban it away? Because Brazil clearly feel like it's a very strong pick, but none of the other regions have shown any propensity towards the Soraka. So do you call that bluff and say, okay, we'll take it and not ban it on red side? It's risky for them if they are, in fact, ahead of the curve, yeah, but certainly is one to think about here.
And it has often been a ban of theirs on the blue side as well. Yeah. So it's not like Brazil looking to try and pick that one up as a first rotation pick or anything like that. But so far, it has been the Kindred and the Mundo, of course, very strong at the moment. Kindred hasn't seen all that much success, apart from in the 1v1s, where she's a little bit ridiculous. His Fortune and Kassadin, though, have been taken away on the side of Brazil. So the Kassadin pick, look, you mentioned that it was something that could possibly undo Brazil. Not going to this game.
I like it. I like banning it away. If you're not looking to pick it, Kassadin, you can pretty much blind pick into the middle lane in most matchups these days. Yep. Kassadin is a fairly safe mid lane pick, so I like it. Take it away. Give yourself the counter pick for that middle lane.
Well, Soraka has been banned away, so Brazil, last ban on the red side of the Rift as well. They just don't want to see the Hoofed Lady at all. Bananas, not going to be happening. So unless they just don't like potassium, they must find something in that champion that seems to be working. But Tahm Kench left available, and he's going to be locked in first up here by Smurf. Could potentially be going into the top lane, but we'll see whether that actually works, because it didn't last time we saw it.
No, it didn't really. And this is the first time we're seeing the CIS region on the blue side. So we now get to see what their priority pick is when most of the regular bans are through. Tahm Kench outranking Elise here, outranking Kalista is a very interesting strategy. Yes, it's a flex pick. I expect it to go to the support role. Now you can maybe open up the window for Lex to pick up something that's a lot better scaling into the game but needs that extra protection.
That's a very good point. And we didn't mention all of the things that have slipped through the draft here, and Elise being locked in just wasted no time, did Revolta. Picked up that champion immediately, not worried about the fact that, you know, it didn't quite work out against OCE, but he still went 6-0-3 for the majority of that game. Took him a long time to die, and the Kalista is going to be locked in here. We'll see what Loop decides to pair with it. Of course, his Bard is still available, banned away by the Oceanians.
Yeah, it has been very prominent. Tristana was the AD carry we saw yesterday out of the CIS in their game against Turkey. Tristana left a little bit to be desired. Like, it's great for pushing towers still, but generally, tower pushing AD carries aren't that much better now than they ever were. In fact, I'd say they're weaker because of the changes to towers. Generally, just every AD carry is very good at pushing down towers if you can get them in front of them. So the added benefit of a Tristana isn't always there. I'd be interested to see whether they go with it again.
Well, we'll see whether they do. I do like the idea of maybe do a lane swap, grab a Tristana in the top lane, grab the Rift Herald, and then push down a turret. Nullify the extra health with a bit of extra damage from those minions. But look, we'll see whether anyone does decide to go for anything like that. And they haven't yet, so I have a feeling there's something about it that may not be all that good. Rek'Sai is going to be locked away, though, as Dimashke is going to put that one in his back pocket. And Kira takes the Lulu. So that could be going to the top lane in the hands of Smurf, but could also be that Lulu in the mid lane. See what Brazil answer with.
So many flex picks right now.
Exactly.
Kench could go anywhere. Lulu could
go
anywhere.
Yeah, could be support
right
as
now.
Well.
So there are so many options. And what that forces now is the Brazilian team to lock in one of their solo laners. And it allows the CIS region to adapt very quickly on the fly. What is the best matchup for us? Problem with that is you are always going to have one counter picked away. I don't think Brazil are going to hold their support until last. That would be a very weird thing unless they had something really different prepared. I'm expecting Loop to kind of just go Bard, if I'm honest. It's been working so well for him, as you mentioned earlier.
He may as well. Of course, you know, the Thresh Kalista synergy is also there. He could potentially go for that one, but I do love Bard, especially with his auto attack. The fact that you then get the Sentinel proc off that one as well makes a lot of sense. But Kami does have the Gangplank available. Could just put down some barrels in the mid lane. The timer is going to run down. That is going to be GP. Could be going to the top. Could be going to the mid lane, but that looks like any support as well. So Loop really stepping away from the Bard, not going towards the Thresh either.
I'm more interested, in the Annie. And Annie is a champion we don't really see too
love
much.
Love this hover. This is his OP pick here in the AD carry role. We heard it from him first.
We did. In Ultimate Bravery to begin the day, Lex did go off
completely
on the AD Fiddlesticks. But Annie we don't see much of at all in the support role anymore. I mean, always used to be very prominent, has had so many nerfs over the course of the last 2 years, ever since Tabe decided to bring Annie into the support role. And honestly, she's great for harassing in lane, or at least used to be, has great flash engages, but the problem is, when you get past that, she doesn't offer too much more. And there are so many strong AD carry and support duos right now that that can just kind of survive through the Annie harass and then do more things in team fights that Annie just has completely fallen off pretty much.
The thing that I really love about what you just said, though, is the fact that she's now paired with a Kalista. So you can use that Fate's Call after she's flashed in, got the Tibbers down, and when normally she'd just be dead.
Yep.
You can just Fate's Call her all the way back out again. She's going to be safe and can potentially do something as well, something else as well.
My only problem with that is, unless the stun now hits the Tahm Kench and another champion, Tahm Kench just runs in, devours whoever was picked out, and can just run away with them. So it is a tough one to do. Annie can still look to win a team fight, but you always have to respect the ability for Tahm Kench to save the target. Lulu, if she's not stunned, can save a target. Fiora can riposte the stun if you telegraph the flash attempt. So I'm not sold on any support yet, but there is clearly a big wombo combo that can be formed here with the Gangplank, with the barrels, with the Kalista as well.
I was going to say, it didn't actually have to be any support there as the Janna was being hovered, but just Loop having a little bit of a go with us at the moment.
I was going to say, do it, Kami. Pick up Kale. I want to see Kale after a lot of the preseason changes, but Kami is...
Did you say Rageblade?
Yeah, I did. Well, I didn't say it, but I
would have. You insinuated severely.
Rageblade 45% CDR, 100% uptime on Righteous Fury. It'll be great. But what will be great into a Fiora is a Malphite.
Yes. I have a feeling, you know, a champion that is going to be relying fairly heavily on auto attacks is probably not going to be too happy about the Malphite. That being said, does have a lot of true damage options there. You can use those vitals, use that ultimate as well. The Grand Challenge is going to help out in that regard. But Malphite, just generally, pretty beefy.
Adding to the wombo combo as well. That is what the team composition is looking for here from the team of Brazil. Over on the other side, the CIS team running a little bit more of a different kind of composition, looking for a lot of solo lane strength with the Fiora. Won't be able to exploit that too much because of the Malphite, but you've got tower pushing potential from the Tristana. If you can get the Rift Herald onto either the Rek'Sai or the Fiora, you have two global side lane champions that can look to push down further turrets. So the CIS team are playing a little bit more of a complex game, but the Brazilian team can really just look to engage on the remaining members of the CIS team in whatever lane that the side lanes aren't over in with the globals, which would, I guess, be the side lanes. That's why we call them
generally
side lanes, Atlas.
Oh, who would have thought? I wasn't the one actually struggling with
it.
No, I know,
but I figured I'd dig myself out of that by kind of shifting it onto you.
Dig up, stupid. No. Absolutely fine.
I am so ready for Simpsons quotes. This is absolutely my favorite kind of cast.
And the floodgates have opened. But no, one thing that I was going to mention as we do prepare to hop onto Summoner's Rift is that Fiora, Lulu and a Tahm Kench with a Tristana, they are some of the safest lanes you could possibly see. What has been the problem in the early game against Brazil? It's been Revolta, him being able to get around and just destroy people. So maybe their answer is have a whole bunch of safety, make sure that we're not going to get ganked. But we are onto the Rift, ladies and gentlemen, as you can see here in the Margaret Court Arena. Demonko running out, the Master Chef himself. We'll see whether he manages to eat anything this game. I have a feeling he might.
I have a feeling he will. He'll eat quite a lot.
Kami's AFK.
Something's a little bit funny, actually. Yeah, Kami is pretty late to pick up that pot and run to lane.
I mean, it's going to be fine.
It won't result in too much. One thing, actually, as the one versus ones were going on, I was keeping my eye on one of the Chinese tournaments that's going on. And it was IG versus World Elite. And I am getting very reminiscent with this team comp from the CIS team. And I actually watched Rek'Sai go around the jungle up until level 6 on the machete and two
potions.
That
sounds like Kakao.
It was Kakao.
Oh, who
he just
thought?
Sat
Farming.
In the jungle till level 6, never had to touch a lane, farmed all the way up to getting his jungle item and a sightstone. And these are the kind of lanes that I feel like Dimashka could do the same thing. Just kind of be around for a counter gank if he needs to. But honestly, a Fiora into Malphite, not going to snowball too well. Lulu, don't think you're going to do too much against
her. She just equalizes. That's a Lulu in lane.
And the same with bottom lane as well. Yeah. I mean, that could be the way this game goes.
The other thing that I was going to talk about is the fact that Kira has taken the Ignite, so it could actually be the mega lane bully Lulu, as Kami's just trying to get in there for the auto attack, has already sent off one of the parlays and a second. Glitter Lance is going to answer that for some decent trade. We'll see how Kira decides to play this lane, because Lulu can can be that mega lane bully if she needs to be.
Yeah, a lot of harass early on. As soon as Kami gets a couple of levels, he will be okay, but he will have to just choke through his potion to begin this one off. But actually saying that, Kira did use two stacks of his potion as well. So effective health once Kami does get that W up will go back in his favor until the first recall. So it's one of those little nuances here of how you use your potion charges, how you actually utilize that effective health on a champion.
Oh my goodness, that Thunderlord was doing a bit of damage.
Yeah, that is a lot of damage to start this one off.
Certainly is. Having a look down in the bottom lane, level 2 hit by the Brazilian team early on. The Star Ladder folk definitely not wanting to go too far forward with the power of Kalista, especially with an Annie there as well.
And honestly, I mean, the Star Ladder team did the croaks there to begin this matchup and ran into the lane. It meant that they're very late and were behind a little bit on CS, but they are starting to recuperate a bit of that, but you can see that the early game, they have to concede a lot of the lane control over to this Kalista, over to the Annie, just until you get enough, you know, all of your abilities available until you can actually sit in that lane pretty comfortable. It'll take a couple of levels, but they'll get there.
Yeah, speaking of sitting in your lane comfortably, that is not what Kami's doing at the moment, taking infinite harass from Kira. Glitterlance after Glitterlance. See the top lane just doing top lane things where they ignore each other and hit minions. It's very exciting.
try and say that with a little bit more enthusiasm.
A lot of conviction there, wasn't it?
We'll get back up to there in about 10 minutes when something actually starts happening. But one thing I'm interested in this bottom lane, actually, is how the lane matchup between a Tristana and a Kalista actually goes. I've sat next to Crepo a lot all the way through the summer split, and he's been talking about how after the changes to Kalista, Tristana actually has a more favorable matchup because of the way that the bomb stacks up from Tristana. However, with a lot of the changes, with a lot of the itemization, I wonder once you get those first recalls, is that going to be the same way? I'm actually looking forward to seeing this matchup because we weren't predicting a lot of Tristana, and it's only really been the CIS team that's been picking it up.
Well, before the preseason changes, of course, Tristana was considered a very good matchup into the Kalista.
Yeah, it was.
We shall see whether that remains the case. Both of these AD carries haven't changed all that much, to be perfectly honest. Tristana, of course, has lost that reduction of cooldown when she auto-attacks a target with her bomb on it, but she can now Goomba Stomp people to get herself another Goomba Stomp. So that is definitely a great way to play the game. So we'll see whether she's going to be able to do that or not. Kami continuing to farm out this lane, has teleported back. Kira grabbing some extra items as well. Fiendish Codex has been picked up, as well as that Corrupting Potion. And the CS has been regained as far as that lead is concerned for BRTT here in the bottom lane. Loop taking a bit of damage. Explosive shot. Don't share it with BRTT. It's not going to there.
I brought you a gift.
Yes, here it is.
It's flashing and ringing. There's a bell attached to it.
Let's take this damage together. Go on the journey.
Yes, maybe if you're in Ultimate Bravery. That's kind of one way of doing it, but probably not in the 5v5 portion of the International Wildcard. But both junglers right now, so far doing the cacao.
Yep.
Just going to sit in the jungle. There was a little bit of an attempt by Dimashka to get into the enemy jungle, but it didn't really do too much. Meanwhile, in this mid lane, Kami has started to recuperate a little bit of the CS difference that was between the two, but did have to use his teleport in order to do that. Flash in the bottom lane, though.
Yeah, Demonka going down very low. Can use that great health to his advantage. Is going to flash. Now going to utilize it. Rocket Jump comes out. Revolta gets exhausted. Lots of damage from that explosive shot. And Loop takes the tower hit. That auto attack hit the wrong target, but Smurf's in here. It's going to grab the first blood as Annie falls down left. Answers the teleport, but isn't going to be able to get anything back. A fantastic play from the Star Ladder squad.
Great teleport out of Smurf there to get down into the lane. Lep was trying to follow him with the teleport. The problem is Smurf now is going to hit level 6 from this. This little fight may not be over yet.
Yeah, there's another rocket jump. Explosive shots on top of him as well. Revolta looking for the cocoon, not going to grab it. BRTT just forced out of lane.
The problem was that Lep, yes, you can arrive as Malphite, you can get a little bit of damage downer and the slow, but Fiora showing up on with a low health target in her sights is instantly going to get that kill just darting around. And now Fiora is possibly the best champion on the map for that kill to have gone to. Triss is just going to be focusing mainly on towers for the next 10 minutes. Fiora, however, needs to get ahead of Malphite. Malphite right now only sitting on Barmy Cinder. Lep needs to get himself some armor here, otherwise he's going to struggle against a Fiora.
It's going to be very difficult. The other thing as well with the, you know, pre-6 Malphite, like, teleport, What does he do? He just goes down and goes, "Hi, I'm a rock." And then that's about it. Throws out a shard, and that's about all he can do. So we'll see whether Lep's next teleport is going to be the one that makes the difference. Having that unstoppable force is the huge deal. Dimashke looking for the dive, flashes underneath. Kira's around here as well. The ultimate goes down, but Kami, he's going to be dead. Kira may actually answer this one with his life. I believe the Wild Growth's still there. There it is, and Revolta is going to get knocked up and probably deterred from this follow-up. Volatile Spiderling comes in. Cocoon not going to find it. Loop doesn't have the flash from that previous engage, but they're still chasing after Kira. Decides to turn around the other way and potentially fall over. Revolta takes down Dimashke as well. Kira so incredibly low. One more Q is going to do it. That'll be it. Cool guys don't look at explosions, and Loop picks up another one. So evening out the kills. I just don't know why he quite moved around the other way. Maybe the minions were there. Revolta just trying to cut him off at the pass.
The reason was he didn't want to give the kill over to Revolta. It's better to give it over to the Annie at this point. Just cut down in through the jungle and kind of force the Brazilians to split up. In the end, they get both kills. And Dimashke was trying to cut across mid lane to kind of save Kira's life there. But the kills all going to Brazil so far in that little trade. Bit of a risky dive, though, in the beginning of that from Dimashke just completely to start it up. I mean, Kami is going to have that Mandarin available, is going to have the ultimate as well, and you could see it in action. And Kami right now is still feeling the pain, though. You can't really take into account too much other than the CS gap and now the kill onto Kira, but Kami is on a farming champion. Gangplank is going to need a couple of items under him really to be able to do too much in this game.
But does have the added benefit of being able to get that money a little bit quicker than other champions using that parlay, so we'll see how he goes as far as stacking that one up. Really like how you use Mandarin as well. Does that mean that we can use any citrus fruit? Because it eats a lemon? Eats a kumquat?
I don't know, because it's not a... I'm going to level with you, Atlas. I don't know the differences between the oranges and mandarins and tangerines.
They're a completely different fruit.
All I know is it is the size of a tangerine.
Yes.
Yeah. So it could be a mandarin, it could be a tangerine, it could... There's somebody out there that got that reference, and I'm going to be so happy if they tweet me. But if you don't understand that reference, I'm just going to let it go.
Yeah, let it go. It will be fine, I think. I just like it, you know? I felt like it was a colloquialism. One of those things, I just like using that word. Let's get back to the game, shall we? As Smurf is going to try and take down this Rift Scuttler. The Rift Herald still asleep, but eyeing him off warily. You can see BOTT trying to land that pierce, but not going to get through. And Dimashke hanging out, waiting in the wings, seeing whether he can get anything going. Not this time, but we were mentioning the fact that these lanes were going to be very safe. Revolta still managing to pick up a kill so far this game. We'll see whether he can translate that further, but falling behind in the farm, just slightly against Dimashke.
He is like 5 kills fewer than he had.
That is a very good point.
But the CBLOL team actually lost that game. So maybe it's actually beneficial that he isn't that fed, but Loop is in danger.
So much trouble, but Fate's Call, of course, is right there. So engaging on the little Annie, not exactly going to be a fruitful option there, and is going to get taken out to safety. But that's an engage choice that they don't have anymore.
Yeah, it's not too bad right now. BRTT probably wouldn't be looking to use that in a fight. I mean, I'm not expecting a dragon fight anytime soon from these teams. Still waiting on that one. However, Kira is going to have to run away from mid lane. Revolta is there, but Kira turns.
Yeah, Wild Growth comes in. Dimashke, they want to try and take this fight. The barrel goes down. Kami can use that. Oh, get some decent damage onto the Rek'Sai. Revolta still trying to do some work. Gets Polymorph, though, down to about 300 health. Loop making his way in. Dimashke going to eat through that red bar, try and get himself back up to some health, or herself. We're talking about Rek'Sai. The CBLOL side now trying to put some pressure on this mid lane turret. 4 members strong with BRTT in the bottom lane. They are going to be able to probably take this down. They are.
Yeah, they are. I mean, these towers right now in the early game so very weak when it comes to multiple people just standing in front of them. So that's one of the reasons why I am a little perplexed about the Tristana pickup, just in the sense that her primary role previously isn't quite as good for her as it is for other champions. As we were talking about, you can pretty much go up to a tower with any AD carry these days and take it down pretty quickly. I do understand the matchup, though, again, against Kalista, and you can see there is a lead for Lex down in that bottom lane, 170s, 289. So clearly that still does translate. As you mentioned, not many changes to the early games of either champion, so it is pretty much still in favor, and they will get this bottom tower now as well. So the Star Ladder team have themselves a good lead, actually, against the CBLOL team. And Brazil had this great early game that we've talked about so much, and that isn't showing up in this game.
Yeah, and they're about to get the mid lane turret as well. Kira pushing that down solo. Of course, all the pressure that has been on Kami from that Ignite Lulu has been very difficult to deal with and has already netted some fruit for the Star Ladder side. So BOTT trying to collect this farm, but with just the BF sword, doesn't have the Hurricane in order to get any wave clear in, so it's going to take him a while to push that one back up to the turret. 20 CS the lead for Lex in that lane.
What I do like, however, is the Brazilian team in this game. You look at their team composition, they've gone, okay, our decision making isn't great. Let's play a composition where there's only one decision to make. Go.
Yep.
Just flash on people, Malphite engage, does Annie engage, everything, follow up with the crowd control. So I like that it actually removes a significant portion of the macro game when you look at it at this level. When communication's not quite there up to the scratch of, you know, an international team, you just pick engage, and then you win because you kill like two people and you always got the greater numbers. So it's an easier play style to actually deal with. And I'm interested to see whether the CBLOL team can use it as the game opens up.
Well, Demonko, he's going to try and gank here in the top lane as Lep's taking a lot of damage. They do grab the dragon. Lep able to get underneath his turret, but they're not finished yet. Demonko looking for it. The flash is going to get him in there, but out goes Lex. He wants nothing to do with this. Demonko uses that gray health, but Demonko most definitely going to die here. BRTT picks up his kill. That's the carry that wants the kills for Brazil.
I mean, why chase a Malphite under his tower when a Gangplank's there with a teleport? That right there is just miscommunication when it comes to being aware of what the rest of the map is doing. For
the enthusiasm as well. It just seemed to me like they were very enthusiastic about trying to go for a kill when maybe they could have just sieged up, use the Tristana, take down that turret, and get it for free.
Yeah, I mean, realistically, you look at that, the tower could have been taken out pretty quickly. You could have looked to rotate for the Rift Herald and then maybe look to build from that. But now you've given away a lot of pressure because you knew the CBLOL team were previously down at Dragon, and now that the map is basically free for the Brazilians.
Yeah, well, Facecore going to be used again. Luke going to get flashed and then delivered to safety. BOTT might still be in trouble, though, as Kira's making his way up. Hits the Glitter Lance onto the Annie. She has no protection anymore, but is going to flash away. BOTT now in trouble. Everyone's sort of going for different targets. The Ignite's down. Kira's going to net the kill, and Smurf just shoots after the Annie and takes her out. Oh, and she's still reaching for a bear. Thank goodness we got off that. That was a really depressing picture.
It's okay. We found her in the last game. It was right after the recall.
That yes. Was, yes, good.
Oh, pretty goodness. Much where we found Tibba. So don't worry, we know where to locate her. You can timestamp that on the VOD.
I don't think we need to go back to that.
I think we do. I feel really bad, but you know, Lep, we found it. Lep knows where Tibba's is.
Yes.
Bring in the graphic, the worlds when I won't fill in the details again. But at this point, God. You just saw the Rift Herald go over, and I like that response from the Star Ladder team. It's recognizing just how much was used from the globals, using the GP ult, using the teleport ult from Gangplank previously, and then you just dive on people. As soon as you spot somebody that's out of position, there's not enough people from the Brazilian team to actually respond in any kind of way. And yes, it took a long time to take down BRTT, but in the end of all things, it is the Star Ladder team that are maintaining a lead here over the potential tournament favorites.
Yeah, it's a very good point, and we mentioned the fact that, you know, hard random against Pain Gaming, it was a very, very different story, but it looks like Star Ladder side managed to come together in this particular game anyway, and we'll see whether it is just something like a bee in Brazil's bonnet today, because they did manage to drop a game earlier as well. Whether it is just this CIS region being able to find their flow on Summoner's Rift.
I think one of the things that a lot of times overlooked is the ability for a team to quickly adapt to a meta inside a tournament. And there's been so much priority on champions like Malphite and actually utilizing them this just in yesterday and today, that it seems like teams like the OPL team, teams like perhaps the CIS team so far, are recognizing ways that they have to deal with that. I'm still a little hesitant because I don't know how you can deal with a high armor Malphite the later this game goes with the downfall of Last Whisper. But certainly the OPL team earlier began to recognize what they had to change up and picked up a win over Brazil from that, whereas Brazil seemed to be a little bit behind the curve with their Soraka bans. Nobody else has been prioritizing it.
Good point. I mean, you don't know about scrum results or anything like that as far as these IWCA teams are concerned, so it might be that you know, Soraka's just been the bane of their existence. I understand how that feels. You know, there's that one champion that you just can't deal with. Well, just get rid of it every single time. Just means you only have two bans at the start
for
of a game.
That's Rengar. Every single solo queue game, I'm in, it's always a Rengar on the other side. And as soon as I get a Rengar, it's never good.
It is, in fact, a different story. But Rocket Jumpy is going to be used. BRTT protecting his outer turret in the top lane. Now moving very far forward. You can see Revolta making his way up. Loop here as well. Kami does have the ultimate at the ready if he needs it.
Teleports up for Lep, though. And it isn't available for Smurf. So if this fight starts anytime soon, there is the possibility of it being a numbers advantage in favor of Brazil, but they decide not to go for it. I think that's probably the better play right here. Just look to push down the turret with a little bit of range between themselves and CIS. BLTT stepping forward a fair amount in the games that we've watched and is getting caught out more than you would expect.
It's a very good point. And look, Loop has been utilizing the extra safety of the Fate's Call, but it does mean that it hasn't been used as an engage tool just yet. See whether the CBLOL team can actually get to a point where they're able to call the shots, because this is a team comp that we've been talking about the whole time. Engage.
Yep.
They have all of the options, and if they're using them defensively, they can't really get to that point. But still early days, 18 minutes into this game. The game very close at 2,000 gold. Lep to try and extend that by one more auto attack.
Oh, he so wants it. Oh. He so wanted to run up to that tower. I actually think he can right now. With a Sunfire Cape and a Glacial Shroud, I think he can run up and just hit it, but he isn't aware of who else is around. The whole map vision on the bottom side is dark for the CBLOL team, and without a clear number of people on the enemy team, he's not able to put that risky play into effect.
Well, Smurf trying to go in on Lep here does have the Black Cleaver as well, but hasn't been hitting these vitals. You can see there's the Unstoppable Force, the tower that's on very low health, still trying to do some work. The flash comes out. Revolta, though, flashes after him. That is going to be the shutdown. Revolta picks up that kill, and Lep finally gets his turret.
Lep's just like, I can't catch up. I'm not going to flash for this. We'll just get the tower. You get the kill. We'll get out of there. It was traded for a topside tower, though, in favor of the CIS team, so the actual net gain is even. Well, there's no net game. It's just even between the two. There was a kill, and now CBLOL are going to look for the dragon for themselves. This will be the second one of the game for them, but with Dimashka around, I don't know whether they can actually go for this. BRTT is once again over in a side lane the entire map away, and it does mean that his team has to start conceding objectives, and this was something that we saw time and time again yesterday, is AD carries, BRTT was one of them that we did this a fair amount, just not being in the right position to contest objectives like the rest of his team wants to do.
Yeah, it's a good point. I mean, there is one remaining out of turret there, so some standing gold on the map, but if this is going to be the Starlighter's opportunity, grab this dragon. It looks to be uncontested as well. Lots of wards around, so the teleport could come in from left, but not happening. And that is definitely a dead dragon, so Starlighter also finding the dragon, and they're going to kill it as well.
One dragon apiece. And, you know, when you get the first dragon of the game like CBLOL we're looking for, it kind of puts it in your mind that, okay, now we have this availability of five. Five's a very long way in the future, but now CBLOL's team are going to be thinking to themselves, well, we can't actually go for five anymore because we don't really want this game to go that late, because if their Tristana gets to the point where the fifth dragon is available for either team, I mean, realistically, the Trist can deal with just about anybody other than the Malphite. And even then, it depends exactly on how much armor Lep has. I mean, we've seen him get to about 600, but Kira is starting the fight.
Yeah, might be in trouble. Has to use the Wild Growth. There's the Nom Nom from Demonko. Going to be able to get the little Lulu out of there, but Rek'Sai not so lucky. Brazil managed to pick up a kill. That's a lot used in order to get there, but we'll see what else they can gain.
Painful flash by Dimashka. Didn't make it over the wall and suffered for it. And this is the kind of opening that the Brazilian team are looking for. The CIS team, just not really respecting the engage potential coming from Loop, has those distortion mobility boots, just is able to flash in anytime he wants at this point. The Tibbers, the flash are going to be off cooldown so very quickly that CBLOL can always go for the engage, and now is their time to step up to turrets when they have the Malphite ult, when they have the flash Tibbers available. But speaking of the Malphite ult, has to be used to get himself away from that.
Yeah, it certainly is too. Better than using your flash, of course, lower cooldown, so he's going to be able to get himself to safety and Lep able to move on back. But one thing I want to mention is the fact that Kami, he's managed to pick up the Infinity Edge and the Trinity Force by 21 minutes. With 189 CS, I feel like he shouldn't be able to do that, but thank you very much, Gangplank, having a passive that's going to allow you to bank a little bit more for that CS. So get a lot of items.
He's having a very quiet game though, Kami.
Yeah.
Well, this is what sort of gangplanks do, don't they?
They sort of explode towards this mid-game stage.
But it tends not to be what Kami does. Kami is one of those players that takes control of the game normally, and right now he's just conceded a lot of that. He was against Zilulu with Ignite, so not really too much he can do in that situation. But now is Kami's time to kind of open this game back up. He can clear every single wave that the CIS team are going to throw at him and can now affect the map in multiple ways. So I'm looking forward to seeing what Kami can actually do on this because we haven't seen too much of the Gangplank play from him.
Yeah, we'll see what they can do to utilize this double teleport play as well. Now Lep does have his on cooldown. Kami can move around the map if he wants to. Potential split push could be there, of course, with the added wave play that you do have, and especially when you can smack down turrets so quickly on the Gangplank, what with the Eternity Force and the fact that you just build a heck of a lot of damage. Can't crit him, unfortunately, but that is his only downfall in that department.
This game actually feels just like a game that we'd be watching from Worlds. There is almost nothing from 5.22.
Yeah, it doesn't feel pre-season, does it?
No, it doesn't at all. It's been fairly slow-paced. There hasn't been crazy kills coming out of the woodwork in the early game. We've had games that have had like 25 kills by now.
I miss Southeast Asia, you know. I want 78 million kills by the first 20 minutes.
This is a much slower-paced game, and I guess in that respect, both of these teams should be more confident in a little bit more of the macro aspects of these two team compositions when you look at how many games were played that looked like this and how many objectives you can actually look to trade, because now we're past the 20 minutes, Rift Herald isn't a thing anymore. You're back to Baron, you're back to Dragon being pretty much the same as they always were. So now it's just the minor tweaks that came from 5.22. The biggest one is going to be the Yama penetration category
yes.
here. And that is where Lep can start to shine. He has two armor items. You see BRTT is taking a while to kill Damashka here.
Yeah, does get back to his tunnels though. Revolta not going to be able to stop him there either. So just going to clear up the mess that has been made by that Rek'Sai in the top lane, but not going to be able to pick up any kills. And Starlight aside are going to be able to push up this mid lane. No minions to speak of. They're not going to be able to get there. You can see, once again, I mean, the Starlight aside, there's lots of wards all around this map. But Brazil maybe picked it up a little bit from their OCE experience, but other than that, still a little bit blind. Recently moved around towards that Baron to try and get some vision down, but seems to me around this 20-minute mark, it's not exactly what they've been focusing on.
And it honestly feels like the Brazilian team are kind of conceding that they feel like their early game deficit has maintained itself up until now. They don't feel like they're playing in a very confident way where they're diving towers looking for plays. And a lot of that is to do with the way that Dimonko is going to be playing as this game continues.
Yeah.
We haven't talked too much about the Tahmkench since Champion Select, but of course, anytime there is a dive, a Malphite ultimate, Tibbers going down, Dimonko's going to save whoever gets caught out. And that does make it difficult to dive a tower, because if you throw everything at one person and they survive, then you're stuck between enemy lines and you're going to take a lot of damage and probably lose that fight.
Yeah, and it's actually built up the Eye of the Equinox as well. Like, instead of grabbing that face of the mountain, wants to be able to put down some wards at the same time. Do like that. He's talking to Yamato Cannon, saying that that's probably the only gold-efficient one that he'd want to pick up. But look, I think that was largely opinion-based. See whether it proves itself later down the track.
Also, knowing Yamato's kind of feelings on item builds, especially with Ultimate Bravery, I'm not sure I trust everything that man says. I do,
Ultimate Bravery
but, you know.
Warps one's mind, Stress. You know, you can't really use that as a way to tell about a man. But right. Smurf is going to be able to clear out this minion wave here in the top lane. We're going to leave talk of that
game mode to
rest.
I'm going to get back down, and Yamato is going to like badmouth me in a rhyme. That's what he's been doing all day, is saying short rhymes.
Ah.
It's going to be kind of aggressive towards me, I can tell.
I'm looking forward to it.
I am. I hope it goes out on broadcast. I hope he prepares something for us when we go back down to the analyst desk.
I hope he's listening. Well, Lep, once again, fighting Smurf. Is going to find a vital there this time. One more as well. Grand Challenge goes down, but uses his QSS, because, of course, the standard item on a Malphite is a QSS. He's going to be able to get out of that. More vitals going to be proc. Smurf saying, okay, well, if you're going to buy silly items, I'm going to hit you with my silly abilities. And it's running out of mana, forces the ultimate, and left. That teleport is just going to mean I'm a rock one more time. But the Starlight are looking for the knockup, finds it there, just Damashka onto a couple of members, immediately dies for it, but does get a fair bit of damage down. The ultimate from Kira doing some work. Lex trying to get some autos over the top.
is able to kill the barrel somehow as well. And now the teleport comes in. Smurf looking to try and get over the top. Is going to do so. Lep without the ultimate, but still is large. Trying to get in front of his teammates. Brazil going for this dragon. That is definitely game. Smurf over there. The riposte comes down. BRTT takes a lot of damage. Lex still safe in the backline. Loop gets exhausted. That's an odd target to use that on. Fate's Call comes down. Kami still at full health. But Smurf now trying to take down Lep. He's just very angry at that player. Kami as well, he's going to follow, but no! Lex gets taken down, Kami gets destroyed, Smurf is gigantic, that's a triple kill! That is very close to the ace, and Loop is wondering where his team went.
A massive set of players from the StarLadder team that all stem from the fact that the CBLOL team just used all of their ultimates. The only one that remained was the Kalista ult, and with everybody below half health, it was an easy decision for the CIS region to go aggressive there. As soon as Smurf showed up, he knew there was no Malphite ultimate to contend with, he knew he had free reign to open up in this team fight. At this point, everything has been used. Lep basically is offering nothing there, and Smurf even manages to just riposte a little bit of crowd control there and return it. From here, it is all systems go for Smurf onto Lep. Lep can't survive through this early on. Lex picks up the kill, and it's just reset after reset to begin with. And then Smurf goes in and cleans up, tidies up the rest of it.
Yeah, it seemed like Lex was just going in as a bit of a bait play there, just to make sure that, you know, okay, Smurf, you'll be fine. I'm just going to die.
I think he thought Tom Kench was running after him. Kind of save him, but he went a little too far.
Oh, the Tom Kench factor. You always got to factor that in. AD carries think that they're always immortal.
Yeah. Well, that was a lot of the reason why the CBLOL team had used so many of their ultimates, is when it came to the engage and the skirmish that was happening around Dragon previous to that, Tom Kench was doing so much work of just nullifying everything that the Brazilian team were throwing at the CIS team. And once again, we're seeing one of the teams that struggled yesterday doing very well against the potentially favorite team in this tournament.
Doing very, very well, and I really love Lex's build. He's picked up sort of the same option as White Lotus, grabbing both of those proc items. And as a Tristana, I mean, you want to be getting those resets. You want to have the extra burst damage available. Rapid Fire Cannon and Static Shiv is going to offer you that.
I'm interested in the Phantom Dancer for BRTT on the other side of the rift, though. Not an item we've seen all that much on. Yes, it's going to give him attack speed. We'll give him crit, which will pair nicely with the Infinity Edge, but isn't really what
we've
seen.
And now as well, the Hurricane Radiant did talk to us about that.
Yeah, so now it's swapped to a high crit build, but...
Oh, Lex is doing so much damage to this turret. The ultimate goes down. Luke tries to get the stun, but Demoko's just going to eat Lex. Now comes out, does have the Wild Growth as well. Everyone on this CBLOL side is so low. Tristana does eventually fall. Smurf making his way over to the fight, and it looks like Brazil able to turn it for now. It's a 2-for-2. Kami and Luke are dead, but it's a lot of damage missing from this StarLadder squad.
And that was an overstep by Lex getting caught out in that teamfight. I kind of want to see what the cooldown was from Demonko to actually not be able to devour once again. As during that fight, just Lex got stunned up. Demonko ate in to begin the fight, and then it was just too late. Too little too late. A couple of more knockbacks were available in that situation. Lex getting caught out is a little unforgivable in that situation because the StarLadder team were in such a commanding position. They got the inhibitor tower, you've got the added range with Tristana with the rapid fire cannon now as well to just take that inhibitor down from as far away as you can. But the CBLOL team throwing as much as they could at the CIS region and find themselves a small fight, but I don't think it's quite enough to get back into this game. They're gonna need another fight or two like that.
Yeah, just getting a little bit impatient. CIS team. See whether they can turn this one. Of course, momentum shifting just a little bit, but it's still a 5,000 gold lead here for the StarLadder team. They do have to continue. Demonko still with that Baron buff rotating around him, but that one is going to be wearing off very, very soon. Could be another objective they could be fighting over sometime in the future. Of course, one dragon to two in favor of the Brazilian, so that could be something that they look for if they can get this game to extend towards the very late stages. That's another Infinity Edge that Kami now has.
Yes, it is. Two Infinity Edges before Boots.
Yeah, he's only got 10% cooldown reduction, though. I really want the Essence Reaver.
He just needs more cooldown reduction from somewhere. I agree with you, Essence Reaver is a nice source for
it. No, but it's more damage, so yeah, it has to be that. There is no other option.
It has to be. But what I'm saying is he just needs it from somewhere. Like, even if he just wants to pick up cheap CDR from Boots right now, it's not the most amazing of things to be, you know, getting level 2 Boots at 32 minutes into a game, but he certainly needs it from somewhere because he's already got 2 upgrades of his ultimate. He's got the Death's Daughter and Fire at Will. He has the double Infinity Edge for the extra crit with the Trinity Force, so he is a force to be reckoned with. The problem is he's not getting the opportunity in any of these fights. There was a lot of damage that came in the last one, but if he can't set up the fights, get the right barrel connections, he's not offering pretty much anything other than his ult in the fight.
It's true. But we have seen that if a Gangplank manages to get a teamfight in his favor, as
goes.
He's trying to find now, Lex does make it out. He's going to use that rocket jump very early, not getting any auto attacks in this one at all, though, as Demonko, he's taken a lot of hurt. Lex is just so good at killing these barrels before they do any work at all. Brazil does have to back away. It was a bit of a skirmish. Of course, the ultimate has gone down from Kami, but that is about it. The teleport from Smurf is something that they did get out, so Lep still has his. So the split pushing Fiora is something that they won't have to deal with for another 3 minutes, and that could be huge.
In they go, Malphite.
Yeah, Lep trying to get some work done. Demonko still alive, using that great health. Kira able to get the shield off, but is going to fall. The auto attacks from Lex doing some work, but that is 2 dead already. Up goes Revolta, but he's very tanky now. Loop trying to get the stun off. He's going to work onto Smurf there, but with the Mercury's Treads, not going to stay stunned for long. Lex now trying to run away. The Flash is going to be used very early. Somehow the Ren picks it up. The double stun from Loop. That is going to be 2 quick kills as Dimashke is going to follow. The double for BRTT. And somehow the Brazilians find the turnaround. Smurf, the last man standing, and they lose no one.
And Lep is going to just make up for everything so far with a great engage from the Malphite ultimate. Blasts his way into the team. And at that point, the Star Ladder team just didn't have much left in the tank. A lot of their cooldowns were used on the initial engagement here. And look for the re-engage here. Lep flash into the Malphite ult. Only hit, well, I say only, doesn't quite clip Lex in that fight, but does hit 2. And from there, Lex just able to survive through Lex, as Lex just doesn't have the armor penetration to punch through a Malphite's armor right now. And just watch for the double stun that's coming up. I mean, this is what Luke has pretty much picked this Annie for. The flash engages, and in this way, the double engage. I don't know why Dimashka actually backs away. I guess he was looking to unburrow on Revolta if he kept pushing forward to prevent a cocoon or block the cocoon. But stacking on your AD carry against an Annie is pretty much the way to lose a fight like that.
May have assumed that, of course, the flash may have been on cooldown. Of course, a lot happened in the last skirmish, but I do like it, you know, camaraderie. Even if it was not exactly the best idea, still, it's better to hang out with your friends, even if you are going to go down. Lex, he's going to destroy the Rift Scuttler, and they're waiting for this Baron to come back up. 16 seconds until that one's there. The Dragon, the third one for the CB LOL squad, is going to be taken here. They've clawed back that gold lead just a little bit, slightly under 5,000 at this point. Brazilian team, I mean, we've been talking them up, and now finally managing to turn fights in their favor. That's a couple in a row that they've managed to take, and BRTT's on 8-2-2.
He is. Oh, Lex got cocoon.
Caught by the cocoon. Dimashke trying to flash forward to get that on Burrow. Demonko manages to save his AD carry, but that's a big cooldown now for the Rek'Sai, especially when you want him doing the engages.
Lep just picked up a Thornmail as well. If it wasn't difficult enough for Lex to do anything in this, that's going to make this game, well, fights pretty much unwinnable if they can't deal with the Malphite. It all depends on does BRTT or Kami get caught to begin a fight. If they survive, this game is very much so still in the Brazilians' reach.
Well, Grand Challenge does go down. They're looking to try and get all those vitals. Revolta able to use that repel, and he's going to be safe. Well, it does go down. Kami deters the Starladder squad from doing any more, but it's just an ult trade in the end.
Oh, this is such a tense set of fights here. It's however many
ultimates
are traded.
BRTT in so much trouble. Rocket Jump comes down. Oh, he got the Buster Shot! And the Explosive Shot are going to be enough. Lex looking to try and turn this one completely. The Inhibitor is definitely going to fall. And those barrels, of course, Lex with laser eye vision for those. They must come up gigantic and red on his screen, and he can't actually not click on them because he's killed every barrel he's been in range of. And that's going to be 2 very quick Inhibitors. And this is what happens when you lose anything against a Tristana. She can just take it all away so quickly. especially with this build. I mean, there's a lot of damage there.
I mean, that pretty much has just sealed the deal for the CIS team right now. The CBLOL team just getting caught out, and so many times in fights over the last 2 days, BRTT has just been a couple of millimeters out of position, just enough to get exploited. And it's plays like that that have just either prolonged games and made it more difficult for Brazil to win, or in this kind of sense, maybe even lost the games. Because look at this, the CBLOL team are looking to just establish vision control around, but the globals have been used. Tom Kench gets his teammates over there, and they may even have cut off the rest of the Brazilian team. Smurf, don't go in alone, though.
Yeah, it might be a little bit too early here, as he does have the riposte available, but Kami just gets destroyed. Grand challenge gonna go off. All the health comes back. Loop is gonna get taken down very, very low. It's a decent stun there from the Tippers, but no follow-up damage now that Kami's dead. And Lep as well. I mean, it's good to be unkillable, but not to Kira, who's doing a lot of work with this magic damage. An unstoppable force has to be used to get him out to safety. Revolta was just ignored. I mean, they've gone in on Revolta so many times, they're like, all right. To hell with that, we're not doing that anymore. But now it's gonna be Nexus turrets that are gonna be in the sights of the StarLadder team. Lex wants to destroy them and he's gonna do it very quickly. CBLOL now with the final opportunity to make something happen. Revolta getting crit to the face and Lex just taking no damage at all.
Are they backing away? No, they can end this
third
game.
Third inhibitor.
It's two waves of supers and they're pushing in. Okay, Kami is back up, as is Loop, so it's actually better that they back away now, looking at the overall grand scheme of things. Bottom lane hadn't pushed in themselves, so it is the right choice to back away, but it does give maybe a small amount of hope.
The glimmer of hope.
The glimmer of hope, because now the CIS team are going to rush out and they're
going
to look
for
Baron.
Going? Oh, he's going for the split push. Does have the Void Rush available, so can get back towards that Baron if he needs to.
Well, I've seen this before.
Yes.
Hardly ever works.
Going for the Desperation Baron play. The backdoor Rek'Sai could be coming down as well. Baron is going down very, very quickly. Smurf looking to find his way in. BRTT gets destroyed. Grand Challenge is there, giving him back all of his health. The double knock-up with the Wild Growth. This is the biggest Fiora I have ever seen. Please don't hurt me, Fiora. I didn't mean that in any sort of negative way. As Lep trying to do some work. Dimashke over the side of the wall. And Lex, Demonko's there just helping him out. Baron is a sixth man for the CIS squad. Oh, Revolta grabs the Baron. It is going to eventually fall. I don't know whether that is enough to save them. Smurf still chasing after Loop. And the vitals are going to be procced. Even just uses a fancy riposte for little to no reason. And now the defense is on. Revolta and Kami, the only man available to save this Nexus. And I have a feeling it may not quite be enough. They've got Baron up minions,
and
though.
And Lex isn't there, so, I mean, they've got to get there to do the damage, so the CIS team may hesitate on this.
I think
they're hesitating.
That is true.
The Baron was enough to save this. As long as nobody dies here for CBLOL, they're okay. This has turned into a bit of a crazy game. A slow
start. What is happening?
And now a Baron Steel is going to keep CBLOL in this game.
That's an open Nexus. It's like four auto attacks.
Four versus two at that point as well.
Yeah. That's a lot of respect given from the StarLadder team. BRTT now going to be pushing out this bottom wave. They don't want creeps anywhere near their Nexus at this stage. And there's lots of wards now in the base of Brazil. Teleport going to come up relatively soon from Smurf. So if CBLOL move out of their base before their inhibitors respawn, that is just going to be a Fiora that's going to be smacking on their front door. The front door that does make them lose the game if they lose it.
It's a pretty important front door.
Yeah, maybe it's not even the front door. Maybe it's like the bedroom. I'm not entirely sure.
Well, three of those opening doors have been pretty much pushed through already.
Yeah.
So I guess there's been a lot of warning. A lot of warning signs. Dragon has been taken, the fourth dragon of the game for CBLOL. Kami is still running around in brown paper bags right now.
He is, but he does have the Essence Reaver.
He does, so he's 40% got that cooldown reduction. Which is what he was looking for, but I still... It's so weird to see somebody with level 1 boots still. I mean, this game is going to end with Kami in level 1 boots.
But if the barrels go off, which one just hit Dimashke and didn't do all that much damage, but if they hit the right targets, they are going to do a whole bunch of work. The last Whisper now has been built. Lep still taking a fair bit of damage here from this massively fed Lex. although not all that bad, 3, 4, and 7. But still doing a heck of a lot of damage, has a lot of items at this stage of the game, 42 minutes in. These inhibitors gonna die one more time. I mean, if Starladder are doing anything, they are most definitely playing by the book. You have to kill all the structures and then the Nexus. And they are doing exactly that. Haven't realized that you only need to take down one inhibitor before you can get towards that Nexus, but...
Slow and steady wins the race, Max.
Well, it looks like it may be doing so. There's the flash engagement. Demarco with the god tier nom nom onto Lex. Demarco going in. Revolta is going to get knocked up by the wild growth, and these auto attacks from the Tristana are doing work. BRTT in a lot of trouble. Smurf was just trying to kill the base, which is exactly what you've got to do to win a game of League of Legends. Lex over the top. Don't hit champions.
They're gonna hold.
Hit the Nexus,
oh, no,
man.
No, they're not. Okay.
Oh, it doesn't matter. He just wants as many points as he can. Ends up jumping on top of the Nexus, and the CIS team take down the Brazilians for the Brazilians' second loss of the day. Really well played.
Well played to begin this one. CIS team managed to hold on with